one of my favorite people that I've gotten to meet in this business. Thrilled to be able to call him a friend and reach out to him when everything's going haywire in Game 6 of the crescendo of the 2020 season in World Series. My friend from MLB Network and so much more, Bob Costas. How are you, Bob?
Hey, Rich. How are you?
I am doing very well. How do you want to handle this? Because yesterday, when I came on the air yesterday, I thought, do I talk about the analytics conversation or the way that it ended with Justin Turner? So which do you think is the more lasting and lingering conversation, do you think, Bob, from Game 6?
Well, unless the nearly unthinkable happens, which is that people aren't just inconvenienced and rolling their eyes about Justin Turner, but that someone becomes seriously ill, unless that happens, I think actually the analytics conversation, which is not more important than anyone's health,
right,
but it's just more likely to be a story that continues beyond this moment because it affects the future of the game. Let me preface this by saying that everyone in baseball thinks that Kevin Cash is a terrific guy and a very good manager, and it is impossible that he made that decision on his own. This game was scripted beforehand, the way so many games are scripted beforehand, in consultation with the front office. Analytics, this is not a get-off-my-lawn thing. Analytics are important. Just in case anybody's wondering, I think I was the first person who ever mentioned Bill James' name on national television in the early 80s when I was doing the Game of the Week on NBC. I was fascinated by Bill James and sabermetrics even then. It's a very important part of evaluating players, if you're talking about the Hall of Fame, or you're making decisions within a game, or you're acquiring players, or deciding who you're going to re-sign. It's very important that everybody in baseball have a sense of what the importance of analytics is and use it as a tool. But it can't be the be-all and end-all. Blake Snell was dealing. Not only was he dealing, he hadn't thrown that many pitches, just over 70. If you were keeping score, take a look at the scorecard. The three guys he was about to face, it was the third time through the lineup. He'd faced each of them twice. He'd struck them all out twice. Six at-bats, six Ks. They were a combined, I don't know what it was, 2-for-13 against him in his two starts. Now, you can say that Nick Anderson was the best reliever in the American League in the short 60-game season, and that's true. You can say that, generally speaking, third time through the lineup is a red flag in modern baseball. But Nick Anderson had allowed a run, at least a run, in all six of his previous postseason appearances. And this is where I think of what Joe Torre said to Brian Cashman once. And no one doubts that Brian Cashman is a very good GM with the Yankees. But at one point when Joe was managing the Yankees, he said, Brian, remember, this game has a heartbeat. This game is not being played on computers. It's being played by human beings. Blake Snell is on the mound. He's dealing, and his confidence is rightly high. Nick Anderson is also a human being, even though he's a professional. Does he walk in with the same level of confidence after six consecutive appearances, after an ERA of half a run during the regular season, but now he's been scored upon in each of his previous six appearances in the postseason? How do you weigh Nick Anderson's confidence level against Blake Snell's? And look, if you and I, when we were kids, are playing Stratomatic, then Blake Snell's card in Stratomatic is the same every single time you plop it down.
Right.
Okay?
Yes.
Every single time, the probabilities are the same.
Yes.
But every player, whether he's a run-of-the-mill player or a Hall of Fame player, has days and nights when they're not quite as good as their average, and some where they're better than their average. There were some days and nights when Sandy Koufax or Bob Gibson were even better than usual, and a handful of days and nights when they were less good than their Hall of Fame norm. If you can't see that with your eyes and act upon it, we've gone nuts.
You know what, Bob? I mean, that's they're standing and applauding you here in the studio, Bob Costas. Here on the show, you know, and it's
hey, I want to add one more thing.
Go for it,
so
sure.
You can stand up and applaud again.
Yes, sir.
I understand I've stipulated the importance of analytics.
Yes.
But I'll also say this, that analytics may work in the big picture. It didn't work for Kevin Cash the other night. And it wasn't a second guess. Almost everybody, I'm sure, in the press box, and I'm sitting at home watching, saying, what the heck is he doing? Okay, so it wasn't a second guess. But analytics are important in the big picture, as I've stipulated. But very often, analytics work against baseball as an entertainment product. The pace of play is the most important thing. And the way the game is approached now, with battalions of relievers, with an all-or-nothing approach too often at the plate, which yields many strikeouts, fewer balls in play, deeper counts, and you're getting games that last an eternity. Baseball's supposed to have a pleasing leisurely pace, not a lethargic pace. Few people like baseball more than I do. But think about this. In 1960, and this is not saying, hey, go back to the way they played baseball in 1960, but it's a good point of comparison. Famous Game 7 of the World Series. Pirates 10, Yankees 9. Took, I think, 2 hours and 33 minutes, something like that, between 2.5 and 2:35. 10-9 is the score. Early in the playoffs this year, the Yankees and Cleveland, pardon me, the Yankees win the game 10-9. 4 hours and 55 minutes. Mm-hmm. And before somebody says there was a rain delay, I'm subtracting the 31-minute rain delay.
That's right.
4 hours, 55 minutes, same score, twice as long. Twice as long. This is baseball's main problem. And you can point to first base on an intentional walk and save 12 seconds or something, or you can really get down to the nitty-gritty. Pitch clock with nobody on base, and reexamining some of the way the game is approached, because it's hurting baseball as an entertainment product. And now, as I finish this rant,
yes.
Think about this.
Yes, Bob.
Blake Snell has never thrown a complete game in his life. Neither has Tyler Glasnow. Charlie Morton of the Rays last threw a complete game, the third of his career, in 2011. There are going to be guys who someday make the Hall of Fame who have never stood on the mound when a big, important game that stays in the minds and imagination of fans ends. The greatest pitchers of the era will never have an image like Sandy Koufax or Bob Gibson finishing off a World Series or important playoff game, of Tom Seaver wiping his brow in the eighth inning when he faces Willie Stargell, and he's thinking, what did he hit the double off me in the third inning? What did I strike him out with in the sixth inning? And Stargell's thinking the same thing, and any good broadcaster is framing that drama. This approach works against baseball as theater.
The guys get up once again. There we go. It's like a wave here. We're like, we're doing the wave here, Bob. We're doing the wave. I mean, but you could throw Jack Morris in there and so on and so forth. And, you know, it's interesting you mentioned Torrey the other day, because I'm watching that that game, watching Snell get lifted. And maybe it was Smoltz in the broadcast booth. It reminded me of Game 5 of the 1996 World Series, in which, you know, Andy Pettit, who got lit up in Game 1, was up 1-0, a left-hander like Snell. Up 1-0 in a pivotal Game 5, and Torrey let him stay in through the third time in the order, and I decided to look it up to see who was the guy who was up maybe right before the third time in the order, and sure enough, somebody singled to bring up Marquise Grissom to go through the third time in the order, and the person who singled was Smoltz, and Grissom singled. And Torrey still left him in, and that was leading to one of the greatest defensive plays I've ever seen by a pitcher in a World Series game, when Pettit pounced off the mound on the Lemke bunt and nailed Smoltz at third base, and then Chipper Jones double play, and Pettit lasted into the ninth. And I'm just wondering if we got robbed of seeing that Snell could have done that, or do you go to the back to the philosophy that, well, this got them there. This got them there,
well,
and
look,
you know, and it doesn't matter if you're going to go with gut or feel. This got them there, Bob.
A rule of thumb is not an immutable law. You have to be able to adjust to certain circumstances. And keep this in mind. Part of the reason why these analytics apply in this third time through the lineup and watching pitch counts is because you're trying to fit this game into the mosaic of the entire season. So how does this affect his next time out, or we're projecting 30 starts, or whatever it might be? To use a cliche, there was no tomorrow for Blake Snell. This game is completely different from every game during the regular season and even the preceding games during the World Series and playoffs. It's completely different. And yet it was viewed as if it was exactly the same. It was viewed as if you and I were 12 years old and playing Stratomatic. But even you and I would have realized that when we played Stratomatic, we did certain things that complied with how we thought about baseball as entertainment. You know, we understood that intuitively when we were 12 years old.
So
by the way,
yes.
We've been using examples. You mentioned Jack Morris. You mentioned Andy Pettit. I went back further to Gibson and Koufax. But this is important. This is we're not just talking about ancient history.
Right.
Think Madison Bumgarner.
Right.
Think Chris Carpenter pitching a complete game for the Cardinals in the World Series within the past decade.
Verlander. Right.
Does baseball have to be reinvented? The game always evolves, but does it have to be reinvented?
Well, I guess that's my question for you, Bob Costas, here on the Rich Eisen Show. I guess put a button on this portion of the conversation. You speak to as many people as you speak to and have your fingers directly on the pulse as you do. Do you think that this could be a watershed moment where that does make all the general managers who script the games out think twice, or the managers in the dugout saying, I just saw Kevin Cash lit up, and I'm not going to be that guy. I'm going to actually go with my gut and feel when I damn well feel like it, and fire me if you want, which is, by the way, what Chipper Jones tweeted out at the moment, did say,
yeah.
Fire me. You know, I'm. You know, if you want me to take the guy out of the game, do you think this could actually be a watershed-changing moment, shifting moment, Bob?
I have no doubt that there are conversations going on. There's plenty of muttering going on. I think it could lead to a reexamination. Is it going to turn the whole thing around? No, and I'm not even saying that it should. So I'll say for the third or fourth time, analytics are important. It's something you want to take into account, but you can't be ruled by it 100% of the time.
So Bob Costas here on the Rich Eisen Show. Let's move to the Justin Turner moment, I guess, and knowing who he is, and I guess setting the stage once again here on the subject matter. He's beloved here in Los Angeles, and clearly for good reason, and loved in that clubhouse as we saw many of his teammates. Maybe they thought that it was a false positive and they weren't going to run the risk, or they just said, well, screw it, we'll get over it, it doesn't matter. That he's out there maskless. If you're Rob Manfred, what do you do in this situation, Bob?
I think you have to make an emphatic statement. And I feel bad in this instance for Manfred and all of the baseball officials and everybody on every team that by and large did a very good job. All of us had our fingers crossed, but a lot of us, I think, were reasonably skeptical about their ability to get from point A to point Z with all this. And they certainly hit some speed bumps with the Marlins and the Cardinals, but they never quite drove into a ditch. And they were able to get through, and even though it was an odd season and a unique postseason, there were some memorable moments. They deserve to be congratulated for that. And yet, right at the end, Turner gives them a bad look, a bad optic here. And so I think he has to realize that. Manfred has to make a statement. It can't be overly punitive, but it has to be emphatic enough to make it clear, because the best guess is that to one extent or another, they're going to be playing next year or trying to under COVID circumstances. And they're going to try to get through a full season or something closer to it under COVID circumstances. And if everybody isn't on board 100% of the time, there are going to be problems. And it's a shame, as you said, that it was Justin Turner, because until now, you couldn't find somebody to say a bad word about Justin Turner,
right,
as a player or a person.
It is. It's conflicting for me, to be honest with you, to be sitting in a position, you know, with a microphone and talking about sports and having to opinionate or have a quote unquote take, you know, where, you know, I was stunned to see him back out there. I really, really was. And then I understand, you know, this is the moment that he's been waiting for, the city since 1988. His wife's there. His teammates are out there. But the mask off, and then you hear that baseball is telling him to get off the field, and he basically, according to baseball, emphatically refused. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know what position, if you're the commissioner, that you're put in, that you can't just sit back and do nothing. That's for sure. You know.
The team has to be sanctioned, and he as an individual has to as well. And my guess would be that, knowing that he's a good guy, he's going to come out with some statement of contrition at some point, and people will accept that because reasonable people put a mistake into the larger context of a person's life,
right?
And everyone knows he's a good guy.
So I guess leaving you here, let's talk about one last thing here from the World Series. That Game 4 ending, where does that rank for you, Bob? That was insane. That was wild, that Game 4 ending.
Yeah, it was, and it gave the World Series an identity. Even for casual fans or those who are saying, yeah, you know, I couldn't quite get into it this year, that game was so not just exciting, but so crazy, almost uniquely crazy, that really is the image as much as anything. Maybe Snell being taken out,
yes,
and maybe the last pitch when you see the Dodgers celebrating. But prior to that, that was the image of the entire postseason. And the Dodgers, who are such a good team, basically screw up three different ways on one play. And you have Arozarena falls down.
Right.
And then he's saying to himself, you know, his heart skips several beats. Oh, my gosh, now I'm going to run down. What have I done? And then he's scrambling to his feet and crawling across the plate. The images were just fantastic. And, you know, this is part of what sports is. And I'm not saying anything terribly insightful. You have elite athletes who are highly trained.
Right.
And then crazy stuff happens.
Right.
And if it didn't, well, why would we be as drawn to it? You see something, it's a cliche in press boxes, but you hear it all the time. You can go to 1,000 games, but there's always the chance that when you walk into an arena or a ballpark, you've seen something you've never seen before.
Right, I know, and baseball is such a leader in that. And the fact, again, that Arozarena, a rookie who just became electrified at the most important moment for his team, is the one that crosses home plate, and the one who knocks him in a way, is a guy who wasn't even on the LCS roster, who didn't hit 200 for either team for which he played this year in Phillips. You can't make it off of Kenley Jansen against the Dodgers that thought that they would be able to hand the ball to Clayton Kershaw to wrap things up in a game five. You really can't script it. It really was unbelievable, start to finish.
No, and you know what's something else about it, and we shouldn't take this for granted. We can get rightly concerned about the labor disagreements and COVID and whatever problems. Every sport has issues and things that we criticize. But first of all, even in this strange season, players played with dedication, energy, and passion. And then the moment that you were just talking about, Rich, joy. On Phillips' face, unexpected hero. You know, he's doing whatever you call it with his arms outstretched like he's airplaning around right. The outfield. And then Arozarena's face at home plate, the pure joy of a young guy thinking of what his experience is coming from Cuba. He doesn't even make it to the major leagues until at some point this season, and he's a postseason hero, and he's involved in this crazy moment. That's part of what draws us to sports, the joy of it.
Bob, love you, man. Thanks for the call. Best to Jill. We'll chat soon. You're the best. Thank you.
All right, Rich. Take care, pal.
You bet.
Bye.
You got that's Bob Costas, everybody. Hall of Famer. Hey, you watched all the way to the end. Thanks for that. Watch more right here.